Alhamdulillah. And this is it. The whole book of Imam al-Ghazali, and this is a summary that our brother and teacher Muhtar Holland has made of the Ihya. It's not a summary, he did not change the words, but it's a selection. It's a selection of few paragraphs of the Rubah of Ibadat. Because Imam al-Ghazali, we find in the Rubah, the book of Ihya ul-Umuddin is four quarters. قَسَّمَهُ إِلَىٰ أَرْبَعَةِ أَرْبَعَ. You have Rubah al-Ibadat, you have Rubah al-Adat, you have Rubah al-Munjiyat, and you have Rubah al-Muhlikat. Preceded by the Kitab of al-Ilm. So we have the Book of Ilm as the introduction, and then you have the quarter of Ibadat. The Rubah talking about Ibadat. When we say Ibadat, Ibadah as a word, as a singular word, means to seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, means seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abada ya'budu means to seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, literally means to walk in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, means to take the path. That's abada ya'budu. Now ibada, when we say ibadatun, it means the state of seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but also it means these actions, these rituals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has designed for the human being to do, to practice, in order to express his ibadah, in order to express his seeking for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order to express his ubudiyyah also to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is his submission to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his being really fidel and consistent with himself, consistent with this idea that I'm seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In order to have that consistency, in order to be consistent with yourself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay, you want to be abd, I will give you a few things. If you are doing them, then that means that you are consistent with yourself. If you find them heavy and you cannot do them, that means you are not consistent with your claim. That means it's just your ibadah, is just a claim. Okay? I'm going to see. Okay, here. You are seeking me? I'm giving you this exercise of meditation 5 times a day. I'm giving you this exercise of seclusion once a year. I'm giving you this exercise of fasting, of detachment from material things, from your drink and food and even don't forget that fasting, we are not supposed to talk a lot. Slowly we minimize. Inni sa'im. Hakada. Yeah, we joke a bit to build a good energy, a bit, بمقدار, to build a good energy to drive away laziness, etc., and grumpiness. We say grumpiness. Yeah, to drive away grumpiness, because the sa'am should be cheerful. More cheerful than any other time. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used cheerful, and he was more cheerful, most cheerful in Ramadan. Ajib. Why is that? Because of the meeting with Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam. And we have our meetings. We said this is a month of Tanazzul al-Malaika. The number of Malaika who descend every night and every day in the month of Ramadan is multiplied by 70. 100 in some riwayas, 1,000 in some riwayas. So maybe that's why we had a sinkhole. The weightiness. Last night was a very, very special night. And in Ramadan, there is one Laylat Qadr, but there are also Layali. There are particular nights that are, for example, I can tell you that last night, the energy of last night was special. It was one of these nights. Etc. So you have that meeting, and then that meeting with angels, if you open your heart to, you will be lightened and enlightened. You'll be lightened and enlightened. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. طيب. So in ربع العبادات, Imam al-Ghazali رضي الله عنه نفعنا الله بعلومه آمين is talking about all these عبادات, that these actions, these rituals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-Khaliq, al-Mushar'a, the one who created the Sharia for us, in order, and the purpose is for us to give us a chance to see if we're consistent with our claim or not. تحبون الله? You want to walk in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? فاتبعون يحببكم الله. Follow me and then you will see. يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم. He gave us this. And these عبادات, Imam al-Ghazali, at every book of, at every chapter, he has كتاب الطهارة, كتاب الصلاة, كتاب الصوم, كتاب الزكاة, كتاب الحج. At every book he has أسرار الصلاة, أسرار الطهارة, أسرار الصلاة, أسرار الصوم, أسرار الزكاة, أسرار الحج. The secrets of. It's not the inner dimensions, it's the secrets of. The secrets of tahara, the secrets of salat, the secrets of fasting, the secrets of... And we saw, and Dr. Khurram Murad in the very beautiful introduction, that's one of the texts. It's a must to read, by the way, the introduction of the prologue for this book written by Khurram Murad. It's one of the most beautiful texts I have ever read. I'm telling you, it's one of the, if you want to memorize something, really, memorize that text or paragraphs of that text. If you want to really, that the introduction, the prologue that Khurram Murad has written here is really great. Especially the first three paragraphs, they are flowing like ajib. And you can see the status of the man, that he's not any, lillahi rijal. One of the predecessors, one of the pious predecessors, one of the salaf for this ummah. You want to be salafi? Follow your true salaf. He is one of our salaf. Khurram Murad is one of the salaf. I mean, you see the key translations. The best, and he translated selections. You will find his footsteps everywhere. Yusuf Ali, another predecessor. But Khurram Murad has his... has his depth, has his weight. And his book, The Way to Quran, is a must-have. Even the summary is good, but the book, if you find the book, The Way to the Quran, is a must-to-have. And if you do not have it, it's a must-to-have. And he told us that, Imam Ghazali is not going to give us an esoteric meaning necessarily of fasting. And actually, Imam Ghazali did not really do much or great effort therein. Doesn't mean that he does not have that language or that science or that knowledge, or he does not master it. But at his time, there was a big gap between the Sufi language, the esoteric language, and the ilmi language, the dhahar, the literal language. There was a gap between both, a deep gap. These ones are speaking about wine and this, and these ones are speaking about different languages, and they cannot understand each other. Imam al-Ghazali was a bridge. So his secrets of salat, he goes to the hadith, he goes to the ritual, and he tells you how to find the meaning in that ritual, how to find the spiritual through the ritual, and how the spiritual is actually the foundation for each ritual. The other Sufi masters, they do not talk about much about this. They will tell you, for example, You tell them, give me, if you go to a Sufi master, a true Sufi master, and you tell him, give me an esoteric mudhakara about fasting, about sawm, he will speak about love. He will speak about love, longing and yearning, and that's it. He won't tell you anything about hunger or thirst, he will tell you, if he is easy, if he wants to break it down for you, he will speak about detachment. He will give you something about detachment, but because in the Sufi dictionary, sawm means love. Mahbub al-Ashiqeen is one of the names of the month of Ramadan. Ya Mahbub al-Ashiqeen, O the beloved of the lovers, is the month of Ramadan, is the Mahbub of the lovers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it is the month of burning and longing and yearning for the meeting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you get that madad for that. These months and these occasions and these ibadat and these are boats that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you. Take the ride. You are not making anything. Just take the ride. The month of Ramadan is a boat, is a caravan. Or is a boat. It's a caravan of lovers. Just take the ride. And you will be carried. It's not something that you need to force yourself to find. The meanings are there. The barakah is there. All what you need is to open your heart to receive it and accept it and take the ride. You see, even the awam, even the common people, they come and they pray 28 rak'at, and some of them were disappointed because they found us praying 8, they wanted to pray 20. Some of them, they were disappointed because we are not reading, reciting the whole khatm of the Qur'an. Because ajeeb, and they don't even understand the language of the Qur'an. Why is that? Why is that? It's something natural. They do not come for fajr, which is a faridah. They come for taraweeh. They find it easier. Why? Because they have food or because of the time? No. There is something. There is something. There is a tajalli. There is something. There is an energy that was built since the time of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. He put the capital alayhi salam, and then they kept building in that energy, and angels are coming and building in that energy, and the energy is built. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Sultan of Ashiqeen, kept building that energy. Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, the crazy of the lovers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and of this religion, he came, khalas, he wanted, and he made this beautiful thing and this beautiful bid'ah, innovation of Salat Taraweeh, Jama'ah, and he would oblige the Imam to come in white. And he would stand at the door, he wants everyone to come in white. Why, Sayyidina Umar, you want people to come in white for Taraweeh? From where? Okay, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants them to come in white for Jumu'ah. But why, Sayyidina Umar? He says, because when Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam manifested himself to us for the only time, for the one time we've seen Sayyidina Jibreel in a shape in front of us, he came dressed in white clothes. And Sayyidina Jibreel is the Rasul of the Qur'an. With his own hands, alayhi salam wa radiallahu anhu, he would put the lanterns and he would fix them for the month of Ramadan. And he would make sure that the incense is ready before Taraweeh and after Taraweeh. And he would make sure that there is the water with ice and muhalla is ready for people. And he would make sure of these details. And he created that festival. And subhanAllah, he did not create it, he was going with the flow. Just going with the flow, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started something, and if you keep riding the train, you will reach there. It's a natural evolution. It's not something that, okay, let us now take this direction and that direction. That's the sunnah. And that's the meaning of Khulafa al-Rashideen, al-Mahdiyin, the truly guided Khulafa. It means what? Mahdiyin to what? Mahdiyin to the Sunnah. Sunnah means what? Means the path. So the Sunnah is not a... Sunnah means the direction. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam set the direction. And the Khulafa al-Rashideen, al-Mahdiyin, the truly guided ones, they just continue in the same direction. That's it. They're not creating new things. They're just, because it's going in that direction. It's going there. It's going there. The people of bid'ah, the people of innovation, are those who are changing the direction of the boat or of the train. The people of the sunnah, they just take the ride and continue in that direction. So it is a normal evolution. The bid'ah hasana, the good innovation or the sunnah that Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu started, he's going with the flow, he's going in that direction. And he, the art, his beginning radiallahu anhu in Islam was junoon. And then it became funoon. And then it became sukoon. And that's the path of any lover of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you claim to have love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you start with junoon. You start with the craziness. You start like with that burning. And then it becomes funoon. Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab became the artist, the architect. What kind of smell? And he would tell them, put the lubban, burn the frankincense before and burn the oud after. For Friday, they would bring him the rose. He said, no, the musk for Friday. For other days, you would take the rose. For other days, you would take the oud. Look at the details of the details of the details. These are rituals of the rituals of the rituals. These are etiquettes. These are refinements. And the rituals are actually refinements. It's this, in the same logic. You want to honor, you want to venerate, you want to, in the same logic. You start with praying on time, you will end up, you continue in the same direction. The architecture, putting the carpet straight. All of that is in the same direction. Because it's all about ta'zeem, it's all about veneration, it's all about making it. Why? These rituals are what? It's really to cultivate awareness, to cultivate consciousness, to cultivate mindfulness, to see the richness in every and each detail. And that's the art that Imam al-Ghazali is inviting us to, is to see the beauty in every and each detail. These details that we tend to take them for granted and just make them in a robotic way. You stand up for the adhan and ajib. You find someone calling to the prayer today and his hands in the... He's standing up to make iqam and... Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Are we making iqam and... Wallahi. Or his hands in his pockets. Making iqama? What are you doing? Or the other one, the iqama is being made and he's standing up like... Hands in his pockets and... What's happening? Do you know you are invited to what? What is it? You see? And if the people claiming to be people murids in the path of ihsan, they cannot keep silent for a few minutes before the salat, so let us not blame the people who come from outside and they keep talking when they enter and they... Let us not blame them. Because it starts with you. If you... You are claiming, they are not claiming to be murids, they are common people. They are common people, they are happy of being common people. It's good that they have come to the masjid, they do not go to the bar. For me, I get so thrilled when I see these people come to the masjid. I don't blame them, why you are not talking, why you know what? But if you build that energy, The first time they will come talking, the second time they will... It smells different here. You are not coming to a place where it smells shoes. It smells very nice smell here, actually. It's not shoes. It's not socks. It smells oud. Very rare Muslim places that smell like that. So make sure that smells nice. Make sure that you put your coat in a mu'addab way, in a good place. Make sure that when people they come, they get filled with ta'zeem, with veneration when they enter. And that's why, that's the only intention why we accepted to start a masjid. For that reason, otherwise why? If it's going to be another corner where masahif are collecting dust and dust in every corner and smell of socks there and you enter to the washroom and you don't find it clean, and if it is going to be another halaqa, another mayon, another mayon de chaîne, another link, or another episode in this Mexican theory of lack of ihsan that we've been watching now and being the actors since like the 1800s, since Tahtawi started his claim. Let us not then. Wallahi, let us abstain from that. Wallahi, there is no need for physical places for prayers, you know? We do not need to make it this beautiful in that way. We do not need to put calligraphies and... No, let us understand where we are and what are we doing, you know? It's not about money. We want people to come and get filled with... And they come and they see you. They see your attitude. They see your smile. They see your energy. Devotion has a smell. And call to the prayer, Imam Ghazali is telling us it has a smell. Because the color to the prayer is what? Is hamilu misk. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is comparing the people of sunnah to the people of bid'ah. And he says, sahibul khayr, the good friend, is like the seller of musk. Musk is perfume. The good friend is like the seller of perfume. If you do not actually put some of his perfume, you are at least benefiting of the smell of his shop. Because the shop of the perfume seller smells nice. And the bad friend and sahib al-su' is like nafikh al-kir, is like the blacksmith. Blacksmith? Haddad. The old kind of blacksmith thing with fire, etc. And it smells so bad. Said, if you do not get hurt with his fire, you cannot escape the bad smell. So let us be sahib misk. So that's why we understand the hadith when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us they are on a mountain, on a ridge, of ridge means like mountain, right? Hill or kathib, top of kathib, yeah. They are on a ridge of a black musk. Three are on a ridge of black musk. The imam. The mu'adhin, if they are leading for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and calling for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a man who has had a hard time making a living in this world, yet is not distracted from the work of the hereafter. That's the best call. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib Ibn al-Musayyib, or Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, he corrected it. His name is Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib. And he said, بَلْ أَنَا سَعِيدُ بْنُ الْمُسَيِّبُ. So we have to respect his decision. Sayyidina Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, because Musayyib means let go of,
released.
The released, the abandoned. Musayyib means the abandoned, Musayyib, the let go of. He said, I'm not Ibn al-Musayyib, I am Ibn al-Musayyib. Musayyib means the one who lets go of. The one who abandons. He said, I abandon the evil. and I'm not. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never abandoned me. So I am Ibn al-Musayyib. Sayyidina Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib said, if a person performs prayer in a wilderness, an angel prays on his right and an angel prays on his left. This is now, if he prays, khalas, you are driving between Montreal and Ottawa, the adhan of the Maghrib comes, or the adhan, and you want to pray in the wilderness. You have at least two angels, one praying on your right, the other praying on your left. Now, if you call for the adhan, and you make the iqama, angels perform prayer behind him in rows like mountain ranges. So the adhan is not this pragmatic tool to call people to pray. It would be more pragmatic to use a ring bell. The bell reaches much further. It would be more pragmatic to use the horn. More pragmatic. But even the bell and the horn, the ulama, they said, and this is between brackets, and there is a ikhtilaf about it, but the ulama, very respected ulama, they said, even if you hear the bell and the horn, say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, because that's a call to prayer. Because that was a call to prayer that prophets have established. And these voices, they should not create in your heart a feeling of repulsion. Because they have not created, because the first one who used the horn was Sayyidina Dawood. So that shouldn't be, The bell was agreed upon, and it was practiced by people, and it was calling people to prayer, and even the bell and the horn, they're calls to prayer, or at least they used to be, or have been, called to prayer. So at least they should not create a repulsion for us. And when we see a temple in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is praised, or at least people, they go to that place, let us not, Allahu a'lam. Some ulama, they said you have to enter with the left and because it is a najis and it is not sacred. But when we see the sunnah of the sahaba, etc., no, it's a sacred place, and it is a place of worship. It is a place of worship, and at least you'll get some few sincere people who really go for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala there. And ala kulli hal. But the adhan is to make the adhan. We said, what is the call to prayer? Is to make the call loud and clear. It's not to call. It's to make the call loud and clear, because the call is already there. Merit of the prescribed prayers at set times, as-salat. Sean, bismillah, fadhal. Aywa. Give him the whole thing. He's sitting on the chair. Yes, he's sitting. Sit. Aywa.
near the prescribed prayers at set times. Allah exalted is He says, prayers have been prescribed for the believers at set times. Said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are five prayers which Allah has prescribed for His servants. For those who perform them properly, without disrespectful omissions, there is a guarantee that Allah will admit them to paradise. To those who do not observe them, however, Allah offers no such guarantee. He may punish them or He may admit them to paradise as He wishes, as He wills. Said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the five set prayers may be compared to a stream of fresh water flowing in front of your house, into which you plunge five times each day. Do you think that would leave any dirt on your body? When they replied, not at all, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, indeed, the five prayers remove sins just as water removes dirt. Other sayings of the Prophet, peace be upon him, the five set prayers are an expiation, for there is something amongst them by which major sins are repelled. What distinguishes us from the hypocrites is our attendance at late night and early morning prayers, both of which they miss. If a man needs Allah when he has been negligent of the prayer, Allah will pay no attention to his other virtues. Prayer is the pillar of religion. To neglect it is to prepare the downfall of religion. Prayer at appointed times, in answer to the question, what action is the most meritorious? If a man performs the five prayers in a proper state of purity, and at the times prescribed, they will be light and approved for him on the day of resurrection. But he who misses them will be resurrected along with Pharaoh and Haman. The key to paradise is ritual prayer. After the affirmation of his unity, no duty Allah has imposed on his creatures is dearer to him than ritual prayer. Had anything been dearer to him than this, it would have become a form of worship for his angels. As it is, each of them performs part of the prayer, some bowing, some prostrating themselves, some standing upright, and some sitting on their heels. Anyone who deliberately misses a prayer has forsaken his faith. That is to say, he has virtually been stripped of faith, since its knot has been untied and its pillars has fallen. The Arabic verb meaning has forsaken is idiomatically much as one might say that a man has arrived when he has very near his destination. If someone deliberately omits a prayer, he ceases to enjoy the protective custody of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, said, if someone makes his ablution and does it well, then sets out with the intention of performing the prayer, he is already in the state of prayer, while on his way to it. With each two steps he takes, a good deed is added to his record, and a bad deed is erased from it. So do not linger when you hear the signal that the prayer is beginning. For the one who is farthest from home will get the greatest reward. They ask, why is it that, Abu Huraira? He said, because all the steps he had to take, according to tradition, of a man's actions, the first to be examined on the day of resurrection will be the prayer. If it is found to be complete, it will be accepted of him along with the rest of his works. But if it is found to be wanting, it will be rejected along with the rest of his deeds. The Prophet ﷺ said, Abu Huraira, command your family to perform prayer, for Allah will provide you with blessings too numerous to reckon. A scholar once said, one who performs prayer is like a merchant who does not start making a profit until he has recovered all his capital. In similar fashion, one who performs prayer gets no credit for supererogatory devotions until he has discharged his basic obligations. Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, used to say, when it is time for prayer, get up and extinguish the hellfire you have kindled for yourself.
Subhanallah. So, lots of seekers in these verses and ahadith. So we said that we, our role on earth is to be seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, if we claim that we are seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we really want to be reunited with our Lord, with our Father, if our claim is true, that we want to reunite with our Creator, with our Lord, in the Christian dictionary, with our Father, with our Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala, if our claim is right, the Quran is saying, okay, you are claiming that you are the children of God, so this is the path to be good children. It's not telling them you cannot be children of God. You are claiming to be good children of God, this is the path how to be good children. If our claim is right, that we want to reunite with our Lord, with our Creator, and we want to seek Him, and we want to engage in His path, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us these gifts, has shown us these khayrat, these nafahat, has given us these gifts, which are the rituals. And the best of them is this exercise of meditation, which is the prayers. So we are meant to receive the gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, because if you are seeking, right? You seek, you want to reach. When you get a rope, so you are in a pit and you want to get out. When you get a rope, you hold on to it or you let go of it?
Hold on.
You grab it with strength or just like this? So these are the five prayers. That's a rope from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a rope. You want to get out of the pit? You want to get out of the pit of your own darknesses and self? He gave you. And if you practice it well, look at that. So it's not a burden, it's not a punishment, it's not a adab, fasting and prayer. These are ropes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, because we are telling that we are seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are free rides, these are mounts, if we want to say, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us. These are energies, these are powers that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us to empower ourselves in the journey of seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to reach our destination fast and safe. إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا. There are two meanings for this verse in Surah An-Nisa, the verse 103. إن الصلاة, the literal meaning will be connection or seeking connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is to be done immediately by those who claim to be believers. Seeking connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is kitab al mawquta, is a must, and it is something to be done in the now. It is something, so it means it's not something to be delayed. If you are a believer, you cannot be patient. Yeah, I will connect with God tomorrow. I will connect with God next month. Or I will, no, it's kitab al-mawquta. So al-mu'minina, those who are in a path of iman, as-salat for them is kitab al-mawquta. It is something that you need to do. Here and now. Immediately. That's the literal meaning. Now, a manifestation of that salat is this salat that we call salat, because it is set for that. The prayer, the meditation exercise that we do, salat, is to establish that connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. It has to be done also immediately, as soon as you hear the call. كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. The best, say, مَا هِيَ أَحَبُّ الْأَعْمَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. They ask the Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, told him, what is the best عمل that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes? Said, الصَّلَاةُ لِوَقْتِ. ثم أي then what then الجهاد. So the first one is الصلاة لوقتها, to pray on time. Pray on time. And he said عليه الصلاة والسلام, there are five prayers, five صلوات, five prayers, فجر, ظهر, عصر, مغرب, and عشاء, the five prayers which God has prescribed for His seekers. So remove servants and put seekers, at least in your mind. Maybe you are saying, but yani edit it. So when we work on edition next time. So you are seeking God? It's that philosophy. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُ تَحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَتَّبِعُونِ يُحْبِكُمْ اللَّهَ. You love God, you are lovers of God, you are seeking God, you want to find God. You want to reach your destination, you want to reunite with God, okay. There are five exercises which God has prescribed, and it is a prescription, like the doctor gives you a prescription, that's the meaning of prescription, for His seekers, for those who perform them properly, without disrespectful omissions. It's not without omissions, without disrespectful omissions. Without omissions with the intention of disrespecting. So if your omission is not with the intention of disrespecting. For example, our brother Eugene is taking time to learn exactly how that at this age, etc. things he doesn't mean to disrespect God. When, for example, he doesn't make his sujood properly, or his ruku' properly, or his, for example, it's not, for example, he's bowing because he has a back pain, or an old man has a back pain, his bowing is like, just he can bow like this, he cannot really bow in the beautiful way, in the complete way. It is an omission, but he's not doing it to disrespect God. He's not doing it because he feels like he's too good to bow to God, or he's too he's above that. No, he's not doing it out of disrespect. He's doing it out of ignorance or out of incapacity or incapability. So the one who performs them properly without disrespectful omissions, there is a guarantee that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will admit them to paradise. Said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the five set prayers may be compared to a stream of fresh water. And the seeker of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are seeking what? What does it mean to ta'budullah, to seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What are we seeking? What are we seeking? We are seeking to reunite with, we are seeking to attach our heart to His that, to His essence. But what are we seeking? How? How can that manifest? We are seeking to have His qualities become our qualities. That's the meaning to seek God. That's the meaning of ibad. We are seeking to have the patience of God becomes our patience. The gratitude of God becomes our gratitude. The ihsan of God becomes our ihsan. Right? That's the meaning of ta'budullah, seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What are we seeking? We are seeking His qualities. That's why in the other hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, مَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْنِ مَا افْتَرَضْتُ عَلَيْهِ وَمَا زَالَ يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهِ فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ صُرْتُ سَمْعَهُ وَبَصَرَهُ وَيَدَهُ وَرِجْلَهُ. That means I give him my qualities when I love him. And that's the end of the journey, when you get the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But in order to get the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what do you need first? Before dressing ourselves with the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what do we need? Logically.
Humility.
We need to get rid of?
Humility.
Yes. And what is the humility?
Pride.
Ah, to get rid of our pride. We need to get rid of our own qualities. We need to get rid of our own qualities, the bad qualities, before going and harvest the qualities of God. To get rid of our qualities are what we call sin. The sins are not the actions. There are the silent sins and the sins made loud and clear. Like the call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is the silent call and the call made loud and clear. So we said that everything around us is telling us, Allahu Akbar, Allah, but we cannot hear. So when the Mu'adhin stands and says, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu Muhammad Rasulullah, Hayya ala salah, he's just making the call that everything is making around us loud and clear. Now sins originally are silent, but you make them manifest loud and clear through your actions. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, وَإِن تُبْدُوا مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ وَتُخْفُوهُ يُحَاسِبْكُمْ بِاللَّهِ. Whether you reveal it or you hide it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He decides to not to make manifest, يُحَاسِبْكُمْ بِهِ,
to hold you to account
because of them. Allah يحفظنا inshaAllah. So the negativity that you are harboring is going to manifest. If not today, tomorrow, after 10 years, after 20 years. And that's how we should understand the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that there will be people who will be acting with the actions, who will be performing the actions of the people of paradise, until there is nothing between them and death left. And they will end up doing the action of the people of the hell, and they will go to hell. This is not fatalism. Rasulullah ﷺ is telling us clearly, they are acting, they are performing the actions. They do not have the state of the people of paradise. They are harboring the negativity of the people of the hell. Sooner or later, like, that's how we say it?
Sooner or later,
it's going to manifest. The pride that you have inside, if you do not get rid of it, sooner or later, is going to manifest. Loud and clear. In the most ugly way. The negativity that you are harboring, the ujub, the arrogance, the sins, these are the sins. These are what Imam al-Ghazali calls al-muhlikat. And the quarter of Ihya al-Umdin is called Rub' al-Muhlikat. And they call it, if you do not have time and you need to read one of the quarters, you need to read Rub' al-Muhlikat. It's the number one. You need to know the sins of the heart. The sins of the heart. Huh? What? The Ihya al-Umdin? Rub' al-Muhlikat? Yes, we have many volumes. Many volumes, and together they can be on pride and this and arrogance, etc. I think we have two or three books.
The red book.
The red book?
Disciplining the soul and breaking the
desires. Yeah, maybe that's one of them. Yeah, ala kulli hal, yes. But you can have them in, I don't know if we have them in one volume or we can have three volumes or four volumes together that will make that ruba, that quarter. طيب. Anyway. So the sins of the heart, these are the sins. These are the sins which are the qualities that we need to get rid of. Before they, there is that, was it Confucius or someone who said, watch your ideas because they will become, watch your thoughts.
Your thoughts before they become ideas.
Watch your thoughts before they become ideas. Watch your ideas before they become
intentions.
Watch your intentions before they become
actions.
Watch your actions before they become before they become your habit. Watch your actions before they become your habit. And watch your habit before it destroys you. And indeed, it's a hikmah, it's a wisdom, purely wisdom. So, this salat, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, look, those who are seeking, those the lovers, the true lovers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are mutatahireen and they are tawabeen necessarily. They are seeking purification necessarily. So, you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you become aware of your human condition. I love Allah, I seek Allah, I seek the qualities of God, but now I look in myself, into myself, and I get aware of my human condition. Inevitably, necessarily, I need what? I need to act on what?
Purification.
I need to seek to be purified. المؤمن متطهر أو لا يكون. So the wudu and the salah, and this is kind of a glimpse of the esoteric meaning. لا صلاة بغير طهارة. The salat is harvesting the qualities of God. The wudu is getting rid of our qualities. Washing your eyes of you, washing your hearing, your seeing, washing yourself of yourself. So it's not because you are dirty. My brothers in the jail, I miss them, subhanAllah. One of them, he came, I took a shower this morning. I'm clean. I told him yes. you think I'm dirty? I'm clean too. I just took my shower this morning too. It's a ritual. It's a ritual. It's to call to our mind that before seeking the qualities of God, we need to get rid of our own qualities. This is one of the things that we need to call to our mind. The five set prayers may be compared to a stream of fresh water flowing in front of your house. Why in front of your house? Because you can pray there. It's right there. It's very easy. You do not need to go on Sunday to the... It's there. It's right there. Into which you plunge five times each day. Look at the Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the teacher. Do you think that would leave any dirt on your body? If you have a pool and you plunge into it five times a day, do you think that would leave any dirt on your body? That's how they replied. They replied, no, not at all. No, not at all, Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet on him, peace be peace, alayhi salam, said, indeed, the five prayers remove sins just as water removes dirt. The spoken and the unspoken sins. One of the dervishes, he says, the secret, the sirr salawat, are to remove the sins of the heart. The jahr salawat are to remove the sins of the loud sins. The secret sins are removed by the secret salat, and the loud sins are removed by the السر بالسر والجهر بالجهر. Secret for secret and loud for loud. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove our sins, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us understanding of this gift that he has given us, and inshallah we learn to be more present in our salat and in this whole process leading to the salat, and inshallah we benefit from our salat more. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us barakah of our prayers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the benefit and the benediction and the blessings of this hour and of each one who is present here, and each one who is watching, and each one who will watch. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the barakah of everyone who comes across or whose path comes across our path. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the barakah of our neighbors. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the barakah of this masjid. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the barakah of this hour. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the barakah of the tawfiq that He has given us to sit together after Salat al-Asr and remind each other of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, to sit with a group of seekers, to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after Salat al-Asr, for half an hour or for 1 hour, is better to me than anything that the sun has reached. That means that's better to me than becoming the owner of the whole earth, because the sun will reach every corner, right? Then to sit for 1 hour with my companions, with a group of seekers, to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after Salat al-Asr is better for me than becoming the owner or having for property the whole earth, the whole globe. مما طلعت عليه الشمس. Everything that is. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq and give us understanding. And it's not just a matter of, because He understands the depth, because if we see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what is being served to us in this moment, we will understand why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us rahmatan min 'indih. Wa sallallahu alaihi wasallam Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi tayyibin tahirin fatihah.